Hello everyone, good morning and welcome to this Accelerating session on SQL. Today we will learn some concepts of SQL and how SQL is useful for reporting team, like whether we might be doing MIS reporting or as a data analyst. It is very necessary to understand what is SQL and how we get the data from the different types of databases. Okay. You must be already working on Excel and some of you might be working on SQL also, but we will have a basic concepts of how Excel is useful and how an SQL database is different compared to the SQL. Okay. So first let us understand like why we should learn SQL and who should learn SQL, okay? I think you can increase the volume from your side. Can others hear me? What about the others?
Yes, sir.
Yes, we can hear.
Yeah, thank you. So let us understand first why we should learn SQL and how we are going to be benefited. But basically, we want to be a report generator or MIS analyst. That is why we are here actually to understand about the data. So understanding the data, what is there within the data, that is the most important part before creating a report. Okay, a data could be a very huge size, like anything. Supposing you are working on a sales department, what are the different sales inquiries we are getting? Everything we are going to put in a computer through some software, or it could be even an Excel. Okay, Excel is not a small thing, even that can store a lot of data. So data will be stored within different tools like Excel or any other means. So we need to understand how data is stored, then only we'll be able to create a report that is more useful for the management. A raw data having thousands of rows will not be directly seen by a management. Okay, a management would like to have a summary of the data, like how much sales happened in the last 1 week or how much amounts have been received from the creditors. Different information will management would be expecting, and that we have to provide it. That's our basic job. And to do that, the most important thing is that we understand what is the data, where is the data stored. Okay. So for that, we need to learn SQL, because most of the organizations do store data in some of the databases, SQL databases. Okay. Whether it could be SQL Server, Oracle, MySQL or anything. Any even mid-sized companies use a servers. Presently, maybe we are getting the support through the IT team. They are getting us the data and giving it in as a Excel sheet. In the Excel sheet, we might be working, but that is becoming a dependency on some other person. Instead of that, if we are able to learn SQL concepts, then we can get the data efficiently by ourselves, because we are the end users. We know what is the data required for our report. So if you are able to write an SQL query and get the data, that will be more useful, and also it will help us grow in our career. We'll be able to give a better performance, because instead of just getting a data, limiting our report to a data that we receive in Excel, instead we'll be able to customize it and get whatever data is required. Okay, and day by day the expectations from the employers are increasing, so it will be more employable only when we have multiple skills. Being a report writer, it's not just sufficient to work on only Excel, though Excel is very famous and used many places, but still data will come into an Excel from some other database, from a bigger database. Day-to-day transactions, we are not going to directly, most of the cases will not be directly entered in Excel. They will be entered in a bigger databases from where we'll be importing the data into the Excel. In the Excel, we are doing analysis, creating different types of reports. So it is very much necessary to understand how the data is stored. Then we'll be able to extract only what is required and give in a short time, we'll be able to give the reports that are required for the management. Okay. Also, many times already SQL might have been written long back. We are just taking the data and doing a lot of complex formulas. We might be writing in Excel. We might be writing some aggregation functions like sum, count, or conditions. We might be getting some thousands of rows, but what we want to report is only limited to, let's supposing, last few months. So we have to unnecessarily get all the data, filter the data from there, and then do the processing. Instead of that, if we know the SQL ourselves, we'll be able to give we'll be able to do it efficiently so that it will be more optimum. We'll be extracting only data that is required for our report. That will be much faster. We can get it and it will be helping us to give more accurate report. Okay. This session I am recording anyway. We'll be sharing the recording. Whoever wants, you can ask our admin. Okay. You don't, each person don't need to record it again. Our recording session is already on. So we'll be sharing that recording, whoever wants it. Okay. And another most important SQL is, we are now hearing about many tools, data analytical tools like Power BI, Tableau, which are cloud-based and very optimized for the reporting. It will be very much an interactive reports wherein a management can easily get whatever form of report they want on those tools. Because, for example, we call it as a like the moment he wants, he can easily change the columns, x-axis, y-axis, and easily get the report. It's called a slice and dice. Slice and dice means we can change the x-axis, y-axis, or the filters, everything on the fly, and immediately give an output. That is possible in the many data analytical tools like Power BI, Tableau, and other things. And to work on those tools, they are mostly, they'll be reporting on a database. So if you know about the database querying, then we'll be able to easily develop the work on those reports. Because after having some experience working on Excel, supposing you want to improve your career, grow in your career, you need to learn new tools. So while working on those tools, SQL database is going to the base, because unless you know the database, you cannot create any report. Okay, so by learning the SQL queries, you can do more efficient reporting. Of course, most of the cases you may have support from your SQL team. Okay, but knowing what is SQL and how to do it, that is most priority important. For any complex queries, sometimes you may have to depend on the expert SQL team, but still by learning what you are doing, what you are expecting, and if you know the SQL, you can be a more efficient and more successful analyst. So that's these are the basic reasons I can think of that would make us learn, trigger us to learn the SQL. Okay. So any other thoughts or any ideas you want to share? So Brahmaya, what do you want? You want to say anything? So Brahmaya, you want to say anything?
Yeah, hello.
Hello? Okay, thank you. So these are the basic concepts. Can anybody want to add anything? Okay. So we understand now that it is necessary to learn SQL. Okay, do you agree? Now let us understand what is a database. Okay. So a database is basically a collection of some data stored in the form, in different forms, like a tabular form. In Excel, we see data is stored in the form of rows and columns in different sheets. So you can call that also as a database. So basically a database consists of different objects wherein we store the data that can be easily accessed. Okay, so basically a data, raw data means multiple rows and columns of data stored in the form of tables. And data, make it more efficient, we store the data in the form of tables so that we can easily access them and generate different types of reports. Okay. And these objects, what we are going to learn, like different types of objects are, for example, tables, views, stored procedures, triggers, indexes. These are the general terms we'll be using in any database. Okay. I'll explain them later a bit. So it's not necessary that each of these objects are available in each database. For example, we have a CSV file, comma separated file. That is also can be considered as a database because it stores the data that is required for the company and also on which basis we are going to create different reports. So for example, a CSV file means, a comma separated values file. Comma separated means, for example, we are importing data from some other source. Some, like we are already having a data available in a Tally software or in an SQL server. Okay, you want to create a report on that one. So that data can be exported from those tools to a CSV file. Okay, a CSV file is going to have the data as a comma separated values. Just I'm seeing if I have any example of that one. So, okay, I'll show you. It's a comma separated value means basically it will be having, supposing a notepad. Let me open a notepad. In the notepad, we can see. Supposing I want to store data in a simple notepad, it's a very simple, basic, very small size application. Like, let me open. These are the sales transactions done in a particular region. So when you want to send it from one place to another, this is the easiest, simplest form of a file. Okay. Here you can see on the top, you are seeing a date, comma, product, comma, sales, comma, region. This is called the header, wherein all the rows in this file, they store the information in the same order. First a date, the product that has been sold, what is the amount, and in the which region. So this is one simple form of a database wherein data is available in a properly formatted way. So we can use this to create a report. What are the sales, product-wise sales or date-wise sales? We can create on this one. So this is the simplest form of a database. Otherwise, we can also create, even in Excel also we use. Already if you are reporting, you are working on the reporting team, you must have seen the Excel files on which we are going to create the reports. So let me show you one sample data. Kindly keep muted so that it will not be disturbing the others. For example, this is the data. We are having the data of different employees. Okay. What is their name? Who is their manager name? The job they are doing and which department ID. This is the information available. Okay. And what is the, here we are seeing the department number only, but we are not seeing the actual department in which department they are working. So this department information is available in another sheet. So you can say this is a simple database consisting of the employee information. Okay, now I want to get the name of the department for each employee. Then I'll be able to now in Excel, we'll be usually writing a VLOOKUP formula to get the description based upon the ID. So if I want department name, here I can write a VLOOKUP formula is equal to VLOOKUP, lookup for this ID in this table. Okay, in this I want to look up for this ID and get the name. Name is available in the second column. So we'll put it 2, false. Okay, this will give the department names of each of the employees that are working here. You have one particular employee, department is not defined, so it's giving an error. To avoid this error, we can write here if error, then show us NA or some comment we can give it. Okay, this is how we can get the department names, and then we can create a report on this, like a pivot table or a chart can be created. Okay, this is one simple example of a database wherein we are having data in the multiple sheets. But the limitation here is that we need to write some formulas to get everything together at one place. In practically, when you see any database, there will be even more hundreds of tables will be there. So wherein we cannot write up formulas and it's going to take a lot of time. Instead of that, some more efficient way is to use a database which is having more flexibility, wherein you can automatically get the relationships without writing formulas. We'll be able to get data from multiple tables. So that's the benefit of using a database management system. Example of database management systems are MS Access. Let's see in Access also, just like Excel sheets, there we store the data in the form of tables. Okay, these tables are related to each other through a key field. Like for example, here in the Excel, we have seen department ID is there in this table as well as in the department table. Here also ID is there. That is how we are able to relate the two tables and get the name of the department where a person is working. Same way, even in these databases, we have multiple tables which are related to each other. So based on those relationships, we'll be able to get the data from multiple tables, combine them together and get the output into a single location, single sheet, from where we can do the reports. Okay. So these databases will not be able to directly open like an Excel file. Instead, they are stored in a predefined format, proprietary formats. We use SQL as a language that communicates with the databases. Okay. So now we understood that database is a collection of multiple tables wherein we store the information related to the our transactions. Okay. And this database, we can get data using the SQL. SQL is the media through which we read the data in the databases and get the output. Okay. So what is SQL full form? What is the full form of SQL? SQL stands for Structured Query Language. It's also called SQL or Structured Query Language. So it is the language that any database understands. So we communicate to the database using the SQL. Yes, it's correct. Okay, we use the SQL as a communication mechanism to interact with the database. And next, another commonly used terminology is relational database. Relational database means it is a database that is consisting of multiple tables that are related to each other. That means there should be a proper relationship between all the tables. Then it is called a relational database. Actually, EF Codd is the, you can consider him as the father of this relational data model. he has conceived around 13 rules. He said that any database that conforms to those 13 rules shall be considered as a RDBMS or a relational database management system. That is, the data should be stored in the form of tables. Okay, and in these tables also, data should be available in such a way that there is some relationship between the tables. And next most important thing is there should not be any redundancy in the data. Redundancy means I'll show one simple example of a data wherein we can understand what is redundancy. Okay. Now supposing this is a some sales order information is available in an Excel sheet on which we are presently creating a report. Okay. Here this consists of the order ID, order date, ship mode, customer ID, name, segment, his customer address is there. Okay, we have a product ID and the product name, product details are there. Are you able to see the Excel sheet?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir. So this is a very basic, normal Excel sheet wherein we see the data that is required for the reporting. In this, everything is there in a single sheet. So normally we think it's very easy, it's best thing that we are able to get a report on this single sheet of data. We don't need to write any formula. Okay. But there are certain limitations here. For example, if I take filter this based on one particular customer, so let me select on this customer. Here, you can see the data, customer ID is there, name is there. Name, some places it is written like this, some places there is a small additional space. Okay, because of this, our report, if we create a pivot table on this one, it would consider these two as two different people. Even state also, you can see some transactions, the state is recorded as a New York, some cases it is recorded as a Texas. So when we create a report summarizing the sales done by this, by state-wise sales, if you look into, you will find that the data report will not be accurate because same customer will be showing some sales on New York and some on Texas. And also one customer will be shown as a two different customers. So this is called redundancy because we are storing the same name multiple times. And when typing, it is very natural to have some errors wherein data could be different. Okay. Sometimes even postal code or phone number might change. So same person, we are going to store as a different people in the system. When everything is stored in single table, there are chances that same person is having information differently on different records. That is going to be giving us a wrong report. We are going to consider this same customer as two different customers and give the information reporting also. A sales done, overall sales may be very high, but because we are showing as a two separate customers, each customer sales will be shown as a smaller value. This is not the best way of doing it. So instead of that, this is called a redundancy basically. Redundancy means same information is stored multiple times. Instead of this, to avoid these problems, what we can do is we shall store the customer names in one separate sheet based on a customer ID, his name, his segment, where he is belonging to, what is the country, city, all the information is stored in one place. Okay, that means for a particular customer ID, there will be only one record. So this is one principle of the relational database management system. Every row should be related to the one key field. Okay, here customer ID, we call it as a key field. All this information are depending upon this key. So if I say I want to know the city where this particular customer having key JY11000 belongs to, can immediately search from this table and say that he belongs to Henderson. Okay, similarly, which region he belongs to, South. So every table is depending upon the one primary key. That is the one basic principle that is in the relational database management system that will ensure that there is no redundancy in the data. Whatever data we are having, an ID always means the same thing wherever report we do it. Okay. Similarly, there will not be any two customers having the same customer ID. Here we are seeing that there are so many rows for the same customer ID. If everything is same, then it would have been nice. But here we are seeing different information for the same ID. So instead of that, we are going to split the customer information into one separate sheet, okay, showing the details of for one particular customer ID, what are the address and the phone number, whatever details about him. Similarly, for the products also, based on a product ID, we are going to store for the category, subcategory, and product name, everything separately. Then finally, there is going to be a table, which is called a transaction table. In this table, we are going to store all the information just like the orders, except that a customer ID only will be stored here. We are not going to have the details about what is his name, city, anything. All those things are always referred to this customer master. Okay, this is called a dimension table or a master table, wherein for a particular customer ID, or the total details are available only once they are recorded. So supposing a customer says he is shifting to some other state, we are going to update this record itself. So later, whenever refer to customer, it will be referring to only this address. Similarly, a product ID is only stored in the transaction table. For this product ID, what is the description? What is the category? Everything is stored in a separate table. This is called normalization also. You can also use a term normalization. Normalization means splitting the data, whole data, into multiple tables so as to remove the redundancy. Target is that anything should be stored only once in the system. Okay, so that whoever refers, whenever we refer to this customer, it will give the same information. So for this one, we have created a table, same data in orders, now has been split into a customers table, which stores the total details about each of the customer. Similarly, a product table stores the total details about each of the products. We also in a unique row, that means for this ID, there can be only one row in this table. That row gives the details about this product. Okay. Now finally, a transaction table is there, which is going to refer to these master tables. This is called a fact table or a transaction table. This table is always going to refer to these customers and products table for getting the details. Here we have only the customer ID. We get the details about this customer by referring to this ID in this customer. Okay, similarly, based on the product ID here, we can know what is the product and what is the details. By splitting this data into multiple tables, we are going to reduce errors in the database, get the from wherever, whichever query we write is going to show the same result. Okay, this is an example of a simple database created in Excel with only three tables. But practically, when we see, as any server may have hundreds of reports like this. So the job of the SQL or structured query, this SQL purpose is to access data, whether you want to store the data or retrieve the data from the database, it is done by the SQL, because any database can understand only the SQL language for communicating between the database and the end user and reporting or an application. Even when you are writing an application, developing an application, wherein new transactions are entered, everything is communicated. Whatever communication between the database and the application, it happens only through this SQL or SQL. This SQL is a common language used by all the databases, like SQL Server, Oracle, Teradata, different databases are there, MySQL. All these databases use this common SQL language. Okay, so in this context, I want to just clarify, SQL is a language and SQL Server is a separate thing. It is a product, database product developed by Microsoft. Okay, don't get confused between SQL and SQL Server. Normally we say SQL.
Hello.
Yeah, tell me.
Sir, I have one doubt, sir.
Yeah, tell me.
So just previously you have shown the like an example you have taken
Excel.
Yeah, in the Excel sheet, how the database we are storing.
Yeah.
And what is the relationship between the customer products and the transaction and last, how we are connecting that.
Yeah.
So how you are relating with the SQL with this in the Excel, the customer's data?
Yeah. In the SQL, each of these sheet is equal to one table. We call in the SQL database as a table. A table is the object where the data is stored.
Okay.
So each of them will be a tables. We'll be seeing, I'll be showing the same data in an SQL server also. Okay. And then we will write queries there, how to get data that is coming from all these tables. In case of Excel, we usually write a formulas like a VLOOKUP, index, different formulas to get everything together when the data is available in multiple sheets. Okay. But these formulas we have to write every time when you get new rows of data. Instead of that, if you store it in an SQL database, we can write some queries. Query is just asking the database for some information. Okay. We'll be seeing that step by step. Basically, here I want to say that SQL, what we use that term, it is a generic term. SQL, it's a language that is used by all the database management systems. Okay.
Right.
SQL Server means it is a specific product. It's a Microsoft product that is one of the database, RDBMS databases. Just like Oracle, MySQL, Teradata, SQL Server is also one application, one database application developed by Microsoft. Okay. So today's examples, everything will be working on a SQL Server. But most of the queries that we discuss that are applicable to any database, whether it is a SQL Server or a MySQL or anything. So each of this SQL is commonly used by all the databases, but they might have some additional features, like they might create some customization, like how we have a built-in function in Excel. Same way there are built-in functions in SQL Server, Oracle, and each of these databases. Those built-in functions will be specific to the database. But the basic SQL query, that is common for all the things. So whatever we learn now, that will be applicable for all the databases.
Okay. So sir, one question.
Yeah.
Today we are basically focusing on SQL Server, right?
Yes.
Okay.
SQL Server, and also our main concentration shall be on querying data, getting data from a server. For the reporting purpose, mostly we are not going to add any data into the server. Okay. What our main task would be to read data from a server where the data is stored in multiple tables or different places. How to get data from multiple sources, create an output, get an output that is suitable for our reporting. That will be looking at. Okay. This I think we have discussed about the RDBMS. RDBMS means it is a database management system that follows the relational model conceived by EF Cord. The main rules he has set in is, like I have shown here in the Excel, there should be a primary key. Okay, this is not a ideal relational database model of database in orders first table. What we have shown in the customers, products, transactions, these are the tables wherein you can see there is a key field that is uniquely identifiable by based on customer ID number. This ID, I can get the all the data correct consisting in the all the tables. In case of a orders table, supposing if you just tell me any single word like a order ID, we cannot get directly related to the product ID. Okay, because there could be multiple products in the order. So there is no direct relation between the fields. It is actually CODD, EFCODD, EF COD, COD rules we call it. Okay, based on that rules, he says that every field, every table should have a primary key and all the fields should be related directly to the primary field. Similarly, there should be a normalization. That means same product description should not be stored multiple times in the table. Okay. a product a customer name we are storing means it should be there only once, like in the customer table. Here this name is stored only once. You are not going to have two rows for the same customer. Okay, and these record, these master tables are related to the transaction by key fields. Here in the customers, customer ID is a primary key. We call it as a primary key, and that primary key is referred in this table as a foreign key. So there will be a direct relation between this key and the primary key in the master table. This is how database is built. Okay, like this, there are many rules. That will be a bit deviation from the subject. Okay. And like, for example, it says that when you are adding a new row here, when you are referring to a customer ID, that ID should record should be already there in the customer table. First, you have to create a record in the customer's sheet that this ID means so and so person, everything. Then only we can create a transaction for that particular customer. Okay, like that, different rules are available. If any database that meets all those rules, it is called a relational database management. Yes, in the customer table, customer ID is the primary key in this table, because here customer ID is a unique record. One customer ID, there will be only one record. So that is why we call it here as a primary key. This ID is stored in the transaction table also. Here, this customer ID could be there at multiple times. Whenever this customer is buying, this ID will be repeating. Okay. So, for example, I implement a filter here. Same customer ID, there will be multiple rows because he has purchased so many times. So, here it will, this is called a foreign key, because this foreign key, this ID is referring to the same ID in the customer table. So, this is called a primary key foreign key relationship between the tables. Whenever you are referring to this AA10096, that means we are referring to this customer by name John Young. Okay, so instead of giving again the name here, name, his city, everything, all the information is already available in the master file. We refer to that master row based upon this ID.
Sir,
so
one question.
Yeah, tell me.
So what is foreign key, sir?
Foreign key means this ID, whenever we are filling a row in this table, transaction table, we refer to the customer by his ID. Okay. So this ID should be already existing in the customer table. Then only we have to use. I can't just create a new ID here. Some XYZ ID I cannot create here. This ID should be already existing in the customer table. Then only I can refer to him here. Okay. That is called the foreign key, referring to an existing primary key from some other table. In this transaction table, it is called the foreign key. There will be a relationship. So in a database, we will be setting a rule. We will say that whenever you want to add a row here, you should always refer to an ID that is already existing there. Like, for example, a product. If you want to sell a product, it should be already there. No, if we have a stock, then only we can sell a product. So if there is a product, means that row should be existing in this product table. First, we should add a row here. A product should be existing in this product master. Then only it can be referred here. So this is called a foreign key, referring to a primary key in the products table. So like this, there are different conditions to be applied. In an Excel, now, a date column is there. If by mistake I enter something here like 523, 2014, still it will accept. It will not give any restriction, though it is not able to recognize it as a date and it is storing as a text. Still it is allowing it here. Okay. But in case of a database, you are going to define what type of data will be stored in this column. We can have a condition that order date cannot be left blank. Customer ID cannot be left blank. So unless there is a data in that one, that row will not be saved in the database. Okay. These are the additional benefits of having a database rather than an Excel sheet. Okay. Every column, we are going to define what type of data will be there, how much size will be there. Everything is defined while designing the database itself. So later when you are storing, all data will be accurate and more appropriate. In case of an Excel, many times when we import data from one system to another system or from Google Sheets to Excel, we might find that some of the dates are not properly recognized. They may store as a text. And when I create a report on this one, all these will not be valid dates and I am not going to get a correct report. But if it is an SQL database, a column will accept only valid values. That row will be saved only when the data you are entering is appropriate to that column. That's how we are going to reduce the errors and ensure that all the data is only valid data available in the tables.
Hello.
Yeah, tell me.
So here actually you explained that in the Excel, yeah, the date format is not written correctly, yeah, but still it is accepting.
Yes.
Is there any conversion formulas in SQL, and whereas that Excel has a text format, but it should show it to the date format in SQL, kind of conversion formulas?
No, we are not going to transfer data from Excel to SQL. Because
so in case I'm asking, if base is in Excel, but data is in text format, but we have to show into the date format. Is there any specific formulas for that?
If there is everything is in that format, then we can do it. Supposing
okay,
few errors are there, then it cannot correct it. But if the whole data is in a different format, while loading, we can define, we can change that format and define it as a date and store.
While loading, okay, sir. That is called SP, correct? Structured procedure or something.
Yeah, TSQL. In specific to SQL server, we call it as a TSQL, transaction SQL.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Yeah.
So coming back to this RDBMS, we have learned that data is stored in multiple tables to avoid redundancy. And also we have discussed about the relationship that can be built between keys. Keys means primary key and foreign key. Okay. And also there can be some constraints. Like I said, a date column can store only dates, or I can say that customer ID should not be left blank. Unless you enter a data there, you should not save the record. Amount column is there. It has to be only numeric. And also I can say the amount cannot be greater than certain value. Like that, we can have different rules and constraints that can be set up in a database. Yes, there are different ways of transferring data from an Excel sheet to an SQL server. There are utilities are there in an SQL server where it can import data from Excel. Okay, we need to write some stored procedures, we call them, wherein we can extract data. Where you want to do some formatting, you want to write a stored procedure. Or you can use a ready-made utilities available where you can import data from an Excel to the SQL server. Okay, now we'll come directly. So what is the advantage of SQL? How it is beneficial over an Excel? In an Excel, normally we open the files, read the data, and then apply a filters, okay, and then get the data. We have to hide some columns or rows by filtering, sorting, everything we have to manually do, get the data, whatever we want, and copy it. In case of a database, we write a queries. A query means basically it is asking a data from the SQL server. I'll say, I want the data for this customer. Here in Excel, we have applied a filter to get the data of one particular customer. Okay. In case of a SQL server, we can write a question. I say, please give me the data of customer ID so and so for the date period or for this product. Anything I can include in my question and the same data will be available. I don't need to go and open the database. Okay. And basically a database is called a client-server application. So most of the cases like SQL Server, Oracle, and all these are client-server applications. That means server will be there separately. It need not be in our local system. If you want, you can install, but in a practical scenario, in an existing scenario, SQL Server, these database servers will be separately installed in separate one system. And multiple clients, multiple users can connect to the same database at a time. In case of Excel, we are keeping the data in the same file and working on the same file. Okay. If you want to work on any Excel file, you have to open the file. Then only you will be able to access the data in that one. But in case of a SQL server, we are not going to directly connect and open the database. We are going to connect it through a mechanism called SQL Server Management Studio. Okay, and connect to the database and get only the data what we want. We don't need to get the complete table data. We'll just get what is required for us. Okay, that's the main difference. Next, we are ensuring that there is no redundancy by splitting the data into multiple tables to remove redundancy. It is called normalization. Okay, normalization is the term used to ensure that the tables or data is stored in multiple tables and avoid redundancy. Okay, and also ensuring that a one key field refers to all the columns in a row. This will avoid inconsistency and ensure that a ID is referring to the same details, like a same customer or a same product or any organization, or everything is identified by a key, so that any query, wherever we write, it always returns the same data. Okay, it's a more efficient management, memory management, because it is stored in a customized format. It is not going to store in a physical files. You cannot directly open a database and see the content. Instead, it is stored in a compressed format, and also it is stored in such a way that you can easily retrieve the data based on the filters. In an Excel, you can maximum in a sheet, you can store 10 lakh rows, but there is no such constraint in when it comes to a database. You can store any number of rows. And there is a concept called indexing. Like example, in any textbook or any large book, if you see, there at the end of the book, we see an index wherein based on the text, you can easily find out which page that particular text is available. Similarly, there is a concept of indexing where the data is indexed based on different columns. Like supposing data is sorted based on the customer name, and that indexes are stored in one table. You can also store data in the form of sort by date and also store the indexes. So these indexing is used to efficiently get the data any short time. It will be much more efficient when compared to an Excel file. Okay. Concurrency control and transaction management is another advantage. That means when you are updating multiple sheets, okay, sometimes you may be successful in developing, modifying one sheet, but it may fail in the next sheet. Even when you write a VBA coding in Excel, okay, Excel, we have a macros. We can write macros in Excel using VBA coding. There, supposing you write 2-3 transactions, first updating one sheet and next another sheet and another sheet. Sometimes after updating the first sheet, it might fail in the second sheet. So the first update will be as it is, but the second place it is not saved. Okay, in such case, we can, in case of a database, we are ensuring that the data is not saved anywhere. Like supposing you are trying to insert data in 3 sheets or 3 tables. Either it will save in all the 3 or will not save in any of the places. It will be reverted. Supposing after saving first table, second table, it is not able to save because of some error. It is going to revert the first table also. So it will ensure that the data is concurrent. Any change done, it will do it all the places or it will not do anywhere. That control is possible in a database, which is not available in Excel. Okay.
Sir, one question related to concurrency control.
Yes.
So concurrency control means like for the same table, we can do, multiple users can write the query and they can fetch data, correct?
Yeah, they can fetch data, yes. Multiple people can fetch data.
Suppose if we want to edit the same row, suppose if you take date colon in any row, Suppose multiple users update the same row, I mean same column, then what will happen?
Yeah, same column means they are not going to update all the rows. Supposing they are accessing different row, then they can update.
Yeah, if the same row, let us consider there is an ID, we are having 50. So yeah. three users are trying to update row having ID 50, and they want to update a column, date column. So then like a recent one will be considered, or what will be the case? Like if three users are trying to
One by one, it will say, first one, it will say, whoever has first hit the update, that will be updated. After that, next one. Like that, last one will be available.
Okay, it will be considered in kind of nanoseconds and microseconds, and it will take the latest one.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Inconsistency means it will not say, like I told you, no, if there are two tables, it will either save both the tables for this change or it will not save both. Like for example, we might have a transaction table wherein we are storing each row-wise details. There could be another table where we are storing customer-wise total. Okay, each customer, how much sales he has procured. The total amount we might be storing in one table. Like, let me take this simple example itself. Here, each transaction is stored separately as a row. And in another table, we might be storing here total how much sales are done by this customer, how much purchase are done by this customer. So this value will be the cumulative value here. Okay. Here it will be for each row and the cumulative value, supposing we are storing here. So when a transaction is saved here, it will ensure that this table, this master table is also updated. If it is not able to update here, it will not save here also. So both will be always consistent. You see the total year for a particular customer will be same as what is stored here in this table also. That is the consistency. So there should not be any inconsistency in the database. And access control and ease in accessing data. Access control means we can give a permission like an Excel sheet. When you give it to somebody, he can either modify it or cannot modify. Only two ways are there. You say read only, he cannot modify the table. If you permit him to edit, he can edit anything. But in case of a database table, we can decide what he can do, whether he can only view the data or he can access only limited data. He can say, you can access only this branch data. Okay, he cannot modify other branch data. Like that, we can put a restrictions. That is called access control. What he can access, what he can modify can be controlled easily. Like as a report writer, we can have permissions to access the data and only get the data. We will not be given permission to edit the data. Okay, that is an extra security. You are able to read the data, do any manipulation, like do any reporting on that one. But original base data cannot be edited. So it will ensure that there is no problem in that there is no data loss because of the reporting. Okay, but in case of an Excel, if you want to add a chart in the Excel sheet, you should have edit permissions on the Excel file, then only you can do it. Integrity constraints. Again, integrity constraints means it should be appropriate, like a date column should have only dates, a amount column should have only amounts, that it will ensure that the data entered is applicable and correct for that one. Multiple user interface. Multiple people can access the data at a time. Okay. Multiple people might be developing reports. Customer master may be used by many people. So all of them can read the data from there without any problem. Any number of people can access the data. Data scalability, expandability. That means you can go on increasing the data for any even 5 years, 6 years data you can use in the same database. When it comes to Excel, as the data increases, it will take a lot of time to even open the file. Because whenever you want to work with an Excel, you have to open the file, then only you can do anything. But in case of a database, you can easily go on increasing the data size and you can retrieve the data for 1 year or 2 years or any data based upon our requirements. We can restrict access to the database by giving a username and password. that we'll be seeing in detail again about the, when we see the actual data, I'll explain you about the data accessing. There are different ways of accessing data. We can restrict who can see what, who can modify or view. All those restrictions can be applied on the database. So these are the basic advantages of SQL Server. Basically, the robustness. We can store lots of data. There is no risk of corruption because we can easily have backups of them. A backup will be much smaller size compared to the database. So we can have a periodic backup of the data and it can be restored back whenever we want. And it need not be physically accessed. We don't need to go and open the database file. Okay, we'll be only accessing the database. Basically, any database consists of a server and a client. A server is a separate system maintained by the admins. And we'll be installing only a client application in our computer to read the data from the server. So multiple people will be updating the same server or reading data from that server. But we can get the data as per our requirements and process it. And now, till now what we discussed is again specific to general, to any SQL, any structured query language. So Microsoft SQL is one well-known database application that follows this SQL principles, RDBMS principles. So that's very widely used. And also there are different versions of SQL Server available. So you can, if you want to install it, either you can install it in a local system for your learning purpose, or it could be on a separate server. Either way it works. So practically when your installation, it will be on a separate. But for the learning purpose, even we can install the server in our own system. That's how we can learn and try to implement our requirements in a database. Okay. If you want to download, this is the path, microsoft.com/ed. So in this, there are different versions of the databases. We have one version called developer version. That is a fully featured version and it is available for free download. You don't need to go for this SQL Server 2019 premises or Azure. Azure, you must be knowing, it's a cloud application. You can store the server on a cloud. But what we best to be preferable is this one, developer edition. This is a SQL Server 2019 is the presently latest version. Is a fully featured free edition licensed for use as a development and test database in a non-production environment. That means only when you are going to implement it in the company, then you may require a license. Till then, for developing the tools and creating the proof of concept, seeing the suitability for your organization, everything can be done in this version. You can directly download this one and install it in a local system. I think if you have around 8 GB RAM, at least that would be ideal for running a SQL Server. Because if less than that, then it will be slowing down. It will take a lot of time to open and close. So if you are having a system with at least 8 GB RAM, you can download and install this database server in your system.
Sir, I mean, 32-bit or 64-bit, sir, which is good with 8 GB?
64-bit, I have tried it. Even 32 should work. It should not be a problem.
Okay, try. Yeah, thank you.
Because that we have to change the system, no? We don't need to change system for the sake of 64-bit. But it should be working 32-bit also. Mine is 8 GB RAM with a 64-bit and I'm not finding it.
Okay.
Okay, I'll share this PDF, sir. Later in that, you can take the URL. Okay? This is
sure.
Simply... Even in the Google, you can directly click on Microsoft SQL Server downloads. This page will open. In this, you can download this one. And installation is very easy for any Microsoft product. Just click on next, next, next. Standard installation, you can do it. Only thing, whenever they ask for username, password, such things, whatever you give, you note down separately. So it will be useful while accessing those things, accessing the database, okay? So this is the where we can install the database in our local system. Once you install the database, next thing would be accessing the database. can be done using some utilities. Like there is a utility called SQL Server Management Studio. This is the user interface used to connect to the server. Okay, this is a client tool. If you are working, you are installing it in your organization, then you don't need to install the database. You can simply install this SQL Server Management Studio. This will have the utility, this will have the feature to connect to any server available in your company where you have the access. Okay. This you can again download using this path. I'll be sharing this information. Okay, if you want, I can put it in the chat also. Let me put this.
Sir, I have a small question.
Yes, sir. Tell me, sir.
So once we download SQL Server developer version, we need to have SQL Server Management Studio in order to utilize it, right?
Yes, correct. Like there is a possibility of using a command prompt also, but it is more easier to work through Management Studio. It is an easy interface wherein just like any other Microsoft product, just right click and do the things easily. That's why we prefer a Management Studio. So this is for downloading the database. And next for the Management Studio, you can use this one. So these two will help us start working on a SQL. Okay, I have created this, already installed it in my system. To access, once installation is completed, installation is very simple, just click on right. You will be able to install it. Once it is installed, then we can access this by using SQL Server Management Studio is the one we are going to link through. So SSMS is the shortcut. SQL Server Management Studio 18, that is the version I have installed. Click on this to open it. So now we are coming to discussion for specific, what is specific to the SQL Server. Okay. The SQL term is a generic word. It is applicable for any database. And Microsoft SQL Server specific SQL, it is available through TSQL. It is called as TSQL. Transact SQL, that is a term used by Microsoft SQL Server to interact with the database. Same way in Oracle, we have PLSQL, Procedural Language SQL, that is specific to the Oracle. Okay, both these languages have most of the things common, like a basic select, basic queries are common in either of the cases. But there will be some specific built-in functions, they are specific to the specific database. Yeah, 4GB RAM may not be good enough. That too, because if you are having Windows 7 or Windows 10, that itself may take 1 or 1.5 GB of RAM for running the Windows. And if you start running this also, it will be slowing. It will be taking a lot of time to open. And other applications like Excel or anything if you are running, it might be difficult. Still, if you want, you can try it out. But if you install this on a 4GB RAM, make sure to stop the service. Okay, wherever you are not using SQL Server, you have to keep it stopped so that at least other things you'll be able to do. When you are using SQL Server, then only you can start it.
Sir, one more question.
Yes, sir.
So Microsoft SQL or Oracle SQL, which one is most famous, sir?
Both are famous, sir. Oracle is a bit robust when it comes to compared to SQL Server. It is there since a long time. And it is a robust setup. That means even bigger databases, they are always in Oracle. Now SQL Server, it has started a bit late. It is also developing. But it is mainly, I can say, used for medium scale companies.
Okay, sir.
Hello.
Yeah, tell me,
sir. Sir, actually, what is the difference between Oracle SQL and the SQL Server, that is Microsoft SQL?
Between SQL Server and?
SQL Server and Oracle-based SQL.
Oracle is a separate company, sir. Like how we compare Excel sheets with Google Sheets. So both are same. Most of the functionality is same. Even you see many formulas also can be written same in both of them. But still, this is a Microsoft product, that is a Google product. Same way, Oracle is a Oracle product, SQL Server is a Microsoft product.
Okay.
basic SQL is same in both of them, but there are some built-in functions. Like in Oracle, we have a two-char, two-number for converting a number to text. Here we have a format function. Like that, some of the functions will be different.
So in the further classes, whether you consider Oracle-based SQL or SQL
Server? SQL Server-based.
Okay.
Like a NVL function is there in Oracle, if you know Oracle. In SQL Server, we have is null. If it's a null, how to handle it? Same thing there, it is called NVL. Like that, some few function differences will be there. But SQL's concept is same. When you want to create a simple table or insert data, it is same in both. So SQL Server is nowadays more famous because of ease of installation. We can ourselves just go on installing a server in a local system. But in case of Oracle, we need to have a DBA. An expert should be there to maintain the Oracle server. And that's why SQL Server has become very famous and easy to maintain. And everywhere, you know, a Microsoft product means you have an option to right click and set up anything. Those things, they are not available in a Oracle.
So today we'll be seeing only Microsoft SQL Server, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So this is the interface where we are seeing the Microsoft SQL Server Management Studio if you open. So this is the interface that we are going to see. So it will be having an object browser. And the first window that we are going to see is this one, wherein it is asking for which server you want to connect to. Okay, we can select whichever server. Because this is a client application, from this client system, we can connect to the multiple servers available in our network. So first step, we'll be selecting the server. Here presently, it is my local system. So the server name, installation name is same thing. Okay, server type is, it could be a database server or analytical server, reporting server, SSIS, you can must have heard of SQL Server Integration Services. All these types of services are available in a SQL Server. So the main benefit of this SQL Server over other one is, here everything is available within the same server. You can have a reporting tool. SSRS reports can be developed and stored within this server. Similarly, cubes and other analytical objects can be stored here. And SSIS integration services, everything is available within this same installation of SQL Server. So presently, we are concentrating on database. So we'll select it as database engine. And then we select the server name, which server we want to connect to. And next, to connect to a server, we should have permissions. So there are two types of permissions. One is using the Windows authentication. Windows authentication means when you are logging into a system, okay, you will be logging in with a login name and password. That is called a Windows authentication. With the same permissions, with the same username, password, we are able to connect to the database also. That is called a Windows authentication. The other one is, we can also create a username and password, like SQL Server authentication means. We can create separate login username password, which is not depending upon the system login. This is a separate login. Okay, well, let us say first connect to the Windows authentication, then we'll see what is the SQL authentication. Okay, so we'll select it as a Windows authentication. It is automatically going to take the username and password that is assigned for this present login to this computer. And we click on connect. Once we click on connect, it is going to connect to the server. And in the object browser, we see what is the server we have connected to. Okay, this is the server name. And within the server, there can be multiple databases. Okay, in case of MS Access, it is also a database management system wherein it does not require a client server. It is stored in the same system itself. It's like a physical file stored in our computer. and it is going to have only one database. Okay, one database will be creating one access database file. It's called a MDF file or AACV file. That is stored as a physical file. But in case of a SQL or Oracle, these databases, we can have multiple databases created within the same installation of SQL Server. So one server can have multiple databases. It could be for different departments, or it is possible that there is one database for the production, that means a live data, another one for testing, one for development. Like that, we can have multiple databases created on a data, on a database server, SQL Server. Okay, here in the object browser, if it is not visible, you can click on view and select the object browser, object explorer. It shows the different components available in this installation of the server. Okay, by initially when you are clicking on opening this one, it is asking for a connection. If you want to connect to any other server also, you can click on this one connect button. So connect to any database engine. It will ask for the username, password. Just select it and say connect. So it is going to create connection for another connection for the server. Like this, you can connect to multiple server at a time. Okay. Now within this server, these are the different objects available. Our main interest will be on the databases. Databases is the where data is going to store. In these databases, the moment you install, first you will be finding these four databases. Master database. This is like a database of databases. Okay. It stores the information, how many databases you have installed in this server, how many users are there and what are their permissions. Everything about the databases. So this is the database about the databases. Okay, about this server, all the information is stored. Each database, where is it stored? Where are the files related to that available? Everything is available in this master database. Similarly, a model database is there, which is like a template. When you create a new database in this system, it will take the basic formatting, everything from this model. Based on that, it is going to store. Similarly, there is MSDB database, which is going to store some transition information. Whenever you are creating any transactions, that information is temporarily stored here. TempDB is also like this. It's a default database created, which will store the temporary information. When you are storing the data before saving, it is going to temporarily store it here. These are the four databases that are default created whenever you install an SQL Server. Further, these remaining databases, what you see, these are the databases I have created. Okay. So let us see, like in Excel, we have seen the database with three tables. Same thing, this is also a database. Here, when I click on this plus symbol, I'll be seeing all the different objects that are available in the database. Okay. A tables is the primary object wherein actual data is stored. All the data, just like Excel sheets, in a SQL Server, data is stored in the tables. Okay. In these tables, want to see the what are the tables available in this database, you can click on this plus symbol. It is going to show the different tables. These are the three tables available in this database. Just like the customers, products and transactions in the Excel sheet. Here we have customers, products and transactions. Same way we have three databases available, three tables available in this database. Customers, products and transactions. Okay. Now I want to see the data from any of the table. We write the queries. A query is basically asking the database, questioning the database for some information. Okay. If I want to get any information, I have to ask the database, give me this information. That info, but we will ask it using a SQL language. This is the T-SQL we call it because it is specific to the SQL Server, Microsoft SQL Server. The language that is used to coordinate with the database, whether you want to get the data or save data into them, everything is done using Transact SQL or T-SQL. Okay, in the Object Explorer, we are seeing the different options available. On the top in the tabs, we can see there is an option called New Query. That means if you want to write a new question, you can click on this one. Control N. Or just click on this one. it will open a new query window. That is by default given a name SQL query 1. Next, if I open another one, it will be SQL query 2, 3, 4 like that. It will be opening. And also it has an ID. This ID is 57 ID, 7, 58, 59 like this. Session IDs will be there. This is used for the advanced users. Okay, wherein you want to do transaction control. As I said before, you want to have a transaction to save all the rows or discard all the rows. That is done using this ID. In the 57 ID, whatever we do, whether you want to save it or undo it, can be done. Again, that is more useful for those who are inserting data or updating the data in the tables. Okay. So before doing that insertion update, let us see actually what is the data available in the tables. Okay. Here, supposing these are the different tables available. And you can see this window here. When I click on this SQL query, you see a name here. This is showing the database on which our present query is going to be executed. Okay. Here, different databases available in this database are shown. On which database you want to execute this query, that you have to select it appropriately. Otherwise, the easiest way is there is a keyword called use. Use sales data. In the drop down, you can see the sales data. Select this one, click on tab. So this is going to tell the system that whatever questions we are writing below this one, everything should be executed on a sales data. Database name sales data, in this I want to execute. Now supposing I want to write a select query. Select query is the very basic query that is to read data from a database. Okay. In the simplest form, we can write select and say, supposing I want to give a sum, I can say hello. Use a text within single quotes. A select statement is going to return this value. Here, because we are not connecting to any server, just we are giving a simple text. So when I run this query, run the query means I can click on execute or F5 key. So it is going to send this question to the database. And we see the result in the below. Here the results we have seen. Hello experts. Because it is a hard-coded simple text, this select query is returning the same thing here. Okay. This is a very basic form of a select statement. Is it clear? Just select and the column, some value. Supposing I want to write a select query on get the data from some table. So the basic syntax would be like this. Say select is called a keyword. Is a select says that you get me this data. Keyword is select. Next, I have to give a column name, which column I want to get the data from. So say some column name, comma. I can use a comma separator when I want to get data from multiple columns. Okay, first column, next another column. So like that, I can access multiple column names. Okay. Let me put a two hashes in the front, because this is a syntax we are writing. Just what are the basic syntax of a select statement I am writing. So this will not be directly executed because we are just saying column name, two like that. So this is the basic syntax of an SQL statement. Select column one, column two. From which table you want to get it? So we'll put in, for the clarity, we can write this select question query in a multiple lines or a single line. From is a keyword, use it to specify from which table I want to get the data. Okay. From, give the table name. Okay. So this will return the data from those two columns, any two columns we have mentioned from the particular table by name, whichever name we give. This is the basic syntax of a select statement. So unlike in Excel, we don't need to get the complete data. we can get only the columns that we want to see. For example, in the customers table, I want to get the customer key and also the customer name. Okay, customer key, customer name, and city also, supposing I want to get it. How to write the SQL statement? Let us see. First keyword is select. Select is the keyword to identify a saying that I want just reading the data. Similarly, there are different types of commands. First, we will see one, two basic queries. Then we will see what are the different types of commands and how to access them. Okay. A select query is written to get the read the data from any database. We use sales data is the syntax required to specify from which database I want to get the data. Okay. Next one, to read the data, first keyword is select. Column name. Supposing here we are having the customers. In this customers, what are the columns available if you want to know? You can expand this object. Click on this one. It shows what are the columns available in this database. Keys means what is the primary key, what is the foreign key, and other keys which are available. Constraints. That means what are the restrictions imposed on each of the columns. Triggers, indexes, all these are the objects related to this particular table. Okay, now I want to see what are the columns available. These are the different columns available in this table. So now let me say what are the columns I want to read. I can say here customer name. So customer name is the two words. So it should be within square brackets. So the moment I start typing customer name, it will show up the list from the table. Okay. Customer name. Comma. What else is there? So supposing I want to get the city. City is a single word, so I don't need a square bracket. So I use here, you observe that this comma separator is only between the columns. After the last column, we do not require any comma separator. So city space. This data I wanted get from which table? So from is that table name. Table name is customers. And end of the statement, we use a semicolon. Okay. Here you can observe this keyword select and from are in blue color. And there is no red underline. Earlier there was a red underline here because table name was not given. Once the query is there without any red marks, that means this is a valid query. Okay. It's a valid thing. We can get it from the data. To execute this one, we can click on this execute button. So in the first query, it has executed and shown the hello experts. Similarly, below that, we are seeing the different customers and their city. So we are interested in these two columns. That's why we asked only these two columns from this table. So it has written all the columns. So this is how we can read data from an SQL database by writing SQL queries. Okay. So any doubts till now?
Hello.
Yeah, tell me.
Sir, I have one doubt. So you have taken one example using Microsoft SQL Server.
Yes, sir.
And you have written one query.
Yeah.
So the same query, is it we will write in a different manner in Oracle-based application? Or
Oracle also, this query will be same, sir. Like selecting columns from its table. This is the very basic standard SQL query. This will work on any of the databases.
Okay. So my question is whether the language is same for both the SQLs or is it different?
Yes, language is same. SQL is common for all the databases. So we call it as a relational database management only when it supports this common SQL queries.
So suppose you have utilized as select and from is the course, right?
No. What's the question?
You utilize the course like select and or from the different course you have used to pull the report.
Yeah.
Customer name and city.
Yes.
Can you speak a little loud? You are not audible. Your question.
No, I am able to hear his question. No problem. Just I'll explain. Yeah, tell me.
Yeah.
So he just repeating this question, select customer name and city from customers. This is an SQL query written in SQL Server, Microsoft SQL Server. And this is a basic query we are using, okay? So this is valid in SQL Server as well as Oracle or any SQL database.
Okay.
So I'll show you one simple example where it is specific to the this particular database. Say, supposing I write select get date. Get date is a inbuilt function specific to Microsoft SQL Server. Okay. Now I want to execute only this query. I can select this one, click on execute. It is going to give the current date and time. Okay. This will not work in the other databases, may not work. For Oracle, instead of get date, there will be something else like get today or some other thing. Okay. Yeah. These type of specific functions are applicable only for any special application like Microsoft SQL. It will have its own inbuilt functions, we call them. Inbuilt functions are specific to each tool. But the standard queries, getting the data from the different columns, inserting columns, these are common to any of the utilities.
So the reason behind asking this question is because my company is using a Oracle-based platform.
Okay.
So I don't know how it is going to be helpful for me by going through Microsoft SQL.
Yeah, that I think I cannot tell you exactly, but basically understanding what is database, how to query data, that will be common in anywhere. And we prefer SQL Server because it is easy to install for anyone. Oracle Server, if we cannot install in a local desktop, it requires more memory, more size.
Okay.
So once we learn it, it's necessary that we practice it and do some projects. So for that, SQL Server is more ideal. That's the reason we are preferring on SQL Server. Otherwise, our course content mostly can be done on Oracle also. But only thing, it is not easy to get an Oracle setup for us to work on it. But if you learn this one, migrating these to Oracle should not be very difficult. Okay. That too, our course, we are concentrating on what is SQL useful for the report writing. To be a good data analyst or a MIS expert, what is the knowledge required? That we will be concentrating on. Okay, we are not going to discuss about the creating SQL new tables, objects, or stored procedures. Those things will not be there because that is more of a specialized SQL developer expert.
Okay.
Capital letters for select and from, there is only a convention. It's not necessary. Even if you write small letters also, it works. But this is a tool having different setup. Like we are seeing it in blue color for all the keywords. Okay. These colors are automatically displayed based upon the settings we do in the tool. But whether it's a small case or uppercase, it still works. Regarding square brackets, these are compulsory if the name is in two words. Like here, there is a space between customer and name. In such case, it has to be enclosed within square brackets to say that it is a single column. Okay. If it is a city, it is a single word. That's why I did not use the square bracket. That's the purpose of using square brackets, to say that it is a single column. If I don't use this square bracket here, it is things that I have forgotten giving a comma separator here or something, and it will give an error. To avoid that, we are using a square bracket. Okay. I'll just give one more convention example here. Instead of writing like this, better way of writing this query would be giving the table name also along with the column name. Here, there could be some cases when we work with multiple tables, same column could be existing in multiple tables. So that system would not be able to understand from which table we are referring to. So ideally, we should be writing here the table name. Customers is the table name. There is already IntelliSense available. On that, click on just to start typing, it will show up the names. So customers. Let me remove this, just rewrite this query. Here, I want to get the customer and name city from customers. So it is the best way to write is first write the table name. Just start typing in, you'll automatically see the name of the table. So customers dot, it will give list out all the columns available in this table. So select the customer name, click on tab. It will automatically add the square bracket, comma, next city. Again, you say customers dot city. And from can go into the new line also, because there is a like, again, this is a just a recommendation to make it more readable. We can write a query like this. Say select customers comma customer name. Here I'll put it, you can write it in a multiple lines. There is no restriction that everything has to be in the same line. Everything you can put in the same multiple lines, and from select from all these keywords, I want to put it in the left line. So here I can put from, give that table name, customers. So this way also we can write the query wherein we are referring to the each column with along with the table name. This is the better way of writing code, because initially we may start with one table, but as we go on writing the query, we'll be combining multiple tables into the same query, in which case it should be easily understandable. Even if it is a unique column, it is there in only one table. Still, if you have this table name in front of the column, it will be much clearer to understand. You can know from which table I am getting this data. That I can easily understand if I have a table name in front of the column. So if I want to execute only this query, I can select this one, click on execute or F5. So it is going to return this data. Okay. And even further improvement, if you want, we can give a alias names. We can give a temporary name to each of them. Like here, let me copy this one. Control-C. Instead of repeating this full text every time, I can give a temporary name to this one. You say select star from customer C. I'll say give a name C to this one. So everywhere, instead of giving the full name customers, I can say C dot customer name, C dot city. See, any letter we can give it as a temporary alias name to that one. Okay. This is also a valid query.
Vinod, I have a question.
Tell me.
The thing is, either in the first scenario or the second model, the query what we are writing. So, in this, while you know searching for city head, we are mentioning customers over there. So, is it necessary that you know every time whatever head we are trying to search, every time we need to mention give the table name? Because from anyhow below that, if we see from the form, we are giving the customers as a table name. So, is it mandatory to give every time?
No, not mandatory. Even this is working. No, here I did not give any table name. This is also working fine, giving the same output. Yes?
Yes, yes.
Okay. But practically, when we write a query, it is going to be quite long. Maybe 3-4 lines of query we are going to write to get the data from multiple tables. So when you're immediately, the moment you read the query after a few days, you may not be able to exactly recall which column is coming from which table.
Agreed.
Yeah. So to for our clarity purpose, we are writing the table name. That is one primary reason. Second reason is if the same column name exists in two tables, like a customers might have a city column, there could be something else like a employees table. Employees table also might have a city column. So when you say a city, if it is existing in two tables, then it cannot, system cannot decide from which table it has to get the data. Then it will give an error. Okay. So in future, that could, such potential problems are there. So it's the best way is to give the table name. Instead of giving the full name, again, if you give the full name, it becomes too long and confusing. So we can give these alias names. Alias name gives the just a
okay. While giving alias names, so is it something mandatory to, before writing a query, do we need to fix that alias name somewhere or is it not required?
Yeah, here we have fixed it, no? From tables, from the from list, whatever name you give, this has to be used in the query.
Okay. Sure. Thank you.
We give it here and same thing will be used. Yeah. Just like a table, even columns also can have alias names. Like here, instead of saying city, I can say customer city. Okay, as I said, supposing city is there in multiple places. Now we are seeing these column names as the headers in the result.
Yes.
So supposing here I want to say this is as customer city. Then it will show this header also customer city. So this way we can ensure that whatever output, like supposing, as I said before, our main purpose is to get the data from here and extract it, to export it to some Excel or somewhere, some other tool, where either we'll be working or somebody else also might be working on that data.
Yes.
So if you are able to give meaningful headers, even that person can easily understand what is this, what city. It's a customer city or an employee city or some other city.
Yeah,
name also, even we can simply say name also. We don't know whether it's a customer name or a seller name or approved name or anything could be there. So to make it meaningful, we can use the alias names
for the sure.
as well as for the columns also, we can use alias names.
Sure. Thank you.
Hello.
Yeah, tell me. So.
Here you're running the queries for the table, right?
Yes.
So do we have to map the table before running these queries from this SQL database?
Map the queries means basically we have to specify the database. That's enough. A database will have only unique tables. A customer's table, there will be only one table in this database.
No, after installing the SQL, so will it show what are the Excel sheets or databases available in that server?
When you first install the server, you will not have any databases except these four. So we need to create these databases.
Okay. So manually we have to create it.
Yeah, we can manually create. Or there are some sample databases provided by Microsoft. This is like AdventureWorks DW2017. This is a data warehouse database provided by the Microsoft. You can import them. I'll show, give the path to you. This is the path wherein you can get a database dump, backup file that can be imported into our data, into our installation, so that we can use it for our practice. Otherwise, there are different options of creating database also. We'll be seeing it a bit later. I think today we may not be able to find time to discuss about creating databases, but that we'll be discussing later.
Okay. Okay, fine. Thank you.
Okay. So this is what we have seen about creating a database, a query with a single table. We have seen that we can use alias names for the product as well as the table as well as the columns. Okay. Now this is like just querying a data, getting a data from an Excel. Okay. In Excel, generally we say range.select or something. Instead of that, here we are able to select the columns. That's the basic advantage of this one. Okay. And further, what we do in an Excel, we'll do some of the features, whatever we do in an Excel. Same thing we'll try to imitate here. Like for example, when we get a data, when we want to read data from an Excel sheet, let me say, I don't want all the customers. I want to see only the customers whose name starts with or who belong to Houston city. Okay, we have different cities here. I want to supposing get data for only particular city. In an Excel, in the customers table, I want to see only Houston data. So I am going to apply a filter here. Say Houston. Yeah, I find so many records. Okay, then I have to copy this and paste it somewhere. Instead of that, supposing in SQL query, I want to filter data based on this city. Then let us enhance this. Now all these queries we have written in this one. This supposing I want to save this directly, I can just save this file for my future reference. Okay. So I'll write a new queries in a separate sheet. Supposing. So we can click on again new query. Okay, here let us start writing some queries with applying the filters. The initial query we have written is, we have selected, okay, one more thing I'll show here. We have selected specific columns. Supposing I don't know what is the column means. I want to see the data and then understand which columns I have to get the data. Because many times column names will be very generic. We may not be able to make out actually what is the content. If I want to see all the columns in a particular table, I can use a wildcard, asterisk. Using an asterisk, I can go to the wildcard. Okay, let me open a new SQL query. Here, I want to, supposing, don't know the what are the columns available in this table, or if column data, I don't know. Based on the data, I want to decide what are the columns that I want to read. So there is a wildcard option. That is, we can use select. Instead of giving the column names, I can use an asterisk. Okay, an asterisk symbol represents all columns available in the table. I can say select star from table name, set dim customer, and click on F5 to execute this. It is going to show all the columns available presently in this database. Okay. Oh, sorry. I got so many columns. Earlier there were only 4 or 5 columns, but I got so many columns because we are now pointing to AdventureWorks DW. This is a different database. Okay. In this database, these are the different columns available. If I want to get only from this sales data, either I can change it here or before this, we can write use sales data and then write select star from customers. Now you can see here it is showing customers. Earlier it has shown dim customer. Because in that database, AdventureWorks DW, there was a table by name dim customers. But here, because we said use sales data, it is showing the tables available in this particular table. So select star from customers means it is going to show all the columns available in this table. So let us, end of the statement should be always a semicolon. Then click on F5. It is going to show the complete data available in the customer table of this database sales data. Okay, so this is how we can get all the columns instead of specific columns. In this, again, I want to see only data corresponding to particular city. City is equal to Houston. So that is done using a clause called where. So just like a filter in Excel, wherein we apply a filter based on a particular city. Here we are going to apply a filter using the where clause. So remove this semicolon. Either we can write in the same line, but ideally, I would prefer to use the multiple lines so that it's clear what are the things we are applying. Here, supposing I want to filter by a particular column. So I'll say where. What is the condition we want to apply? We want to apply a filter on the column city. So city is equal to a text. A text has to be within single quotes. I want to get only the records of this particular city. The semicolon and F5. So it's going to filter and show us only the rows corresponding to this particular city. So this is how we can apply a filter on the data. Okay. Is it clear? So select star means it is selecting all the columns. And we are getting only the data for a particular city. Now here, supposing now I don't require all the columns, I want only specific columns. Then ideally, let us have an alias name here, customer C. And here I can again change it. I want C dot C dot state, comma C dot city, comma C dot customer name. Okay, that is first line. Select list of fields is showing the what are the columns that have to be displayed. Use the asterisk symbol, it is going to display all the columns, or if you specify the column names, it is going to display only these columns. From clause is used to specify the table name, from which table you want to read the data. Next, where clause is to apply a filter. What are the columns, what are the rows you want to see? You want to filter based on only the city. So this is going to return as the only the specific columns from the table customers, and also for only those belonging to the city Houston. Okay, this is using the where clause or applying a filter. In this filter, there are many ways of applying a filter. Instead of saying equal to, you can even say like, or different ways of using the filters. We can even use multiple filters also. Like supposing I want to say, I want to get all the customers who belong to city Houston and whose name starts with say J letter. Okay, how to write this query? Let us see. I want to get all the customers whose name starts with the letter J and who belong to the city of Houston. Both conditions we want to apply. Then we can say select. Again, either if you have a short name, you can write it. Or ideally what we can do is first we will write select star from customers C. Once alias name is given, I can go back and here say C dot customer ID. What are columns we want? Say C dot customer name. Comma C dot, let us say some postal code or segment. Okay, from customer C, where city is equal to Houston. And you want to apply another condition, so use the keyword and. And is a keyword. And what are the other condition you want to apply? Customer name starts with J. So then we can say C dot customer name starts with, that means we use the keyword like. A like within the single quotes J. And for the multiple characters, we give the wildcard percentage. That means any name that is starting with J. So we can run this query. So it returns only those people whose name starts with J and who belong to the city of Houston. Can we use equal to symbols instead of like? No, equal to means it will be same exact text. Like is used where you don't know the full text. Okay, equal to is used where you want to filter it by specific. Like Houston, we have said equal to Houston. And it is there. When you know only the part of the name, we use the like condition. So let me see this question. Completely, you want to ask that just as we are searching in sales data, Excel file data, various rows and columns through SQL. can we do? Apply this same SQL to search others. Here, I am not searching from the Excel. This data result we are not getting from the Excel. We are getting from the SQL database. Whatever is there in SQL server, these Excel files, this I have created a database in SQL server. Okay, this sales data, this is not referring to Excel sheet. Okay, this is referring to only a database with the same name, having these tables. So these queries are working only on SQL server, not on Excel. Okay, is it the same question?
Yeah, yeah. Sir, how can we export that Excel into here in SQL?
There are utilities, sir. There's the import option is there. File. You can go to, I think, a new import database query. Yeah, I think in the tools there are options available. Import, export settings. And I don't remember exactly, but there are options available to import the data. Maybe you can select a database, right click, and say task, import data. Okay, first you need to create an empty database, then click on import data. Here it will give an option in the wizard from which, whether what is the data type, whether it is Excel or Access or anything. Here we select the different options. Okay, in this I have selected the Excel, select the path, type of the file, and it is going to import. Okay, for that, before we have to create one database, for that just select the databases, right click, say new database. Give a name to this one, say test. Okay, it is going to define all the standards for our practice purpose. We can leave it everything as it is. Otherwise, these are the options where you can define where your database should be residing, which folder, okay? And also what should be the size of the database, how it should increase. There are different options available. You can even decide to store data in multiple files. By default, it is going to store only in one file, primary. But if you want multiple places, you can decide and say, okay. So it's going to create one empty database like this, having all the empty objects. There are no tables here. In this one, you can go and import the data using the import utility. Okay. Similarly, you can even export them using those wizards. Microsoft, that is the easiest way to work on. In a Oracle, if you have a company is having an Oracle server, they should have one full-time Oracle DBA to maintain. But in case of SQL server, it's very easy. Anybody can just everywhere simply right-click and you get the options. Okay. That is why SQL Server has become so famous and easily accessible. You can create it anytime. You can simply right click and say even task, backup data, restore database. Everything is available through menu options. You can easily do them. Okay. Let us see. I think we'll concentrate on some of the queries, more complex queries. So I want to show you now how it is useful to multiple tables.
Okay. Okay.
Now, we have seen how to get data from a single table with a where clause applying condition on two columns. Similarly, there are many more types of columns that we can input. Can we input data in SQL? Yes, you can input. Like here, we have used the existing data. Supposing there are other ways. Supposing I want to add a new customer, I can just right click on this one, say select top 1000 means it is writing a select query for us. Okay, similarly edit top 200 rows is there. Click on this one, it is going to open the rows. Here we can edit the data or go to the last and add a new row. Here you can add this information. Say here I want to add ZZ-12345 as a new customer. Okay, this row is added now automatically. Like this, we can add the data or edit the data from this one. First, most often, SQL Server is a database application. So there will be another application, maybe .NET application, C Sharp application, or any Java application that is going to add data to this one. Okay. That will take care of application screens wherein customers adds the information, it is automatically added into this database. Similarly,
even from shape point also, you told like from .NET application, some applications, data will come and store in the SQL tables.
Yes.
Even by using of the SharePoint also, customer can do the input. Those tables also can be stored in SQL?
Like what data, how they are going to enter, like the total documents?
SharePoint actually is the front end, sir. I mean to say SharePoint is a front end. In SharePoint, they can enter the data.
SharePoint actually...
Like front end, you are telling some .NET development, C-sharp, something they will develop.
Yes, yes. No, what I understand SharePoint is for sharing the documents. Is it correct? For any files to share within the office.
That is also available, but the SharePoint, we have a custom objects like creating a tables also and everything, correct?
Okay.
That also can be used as a front end?
I'm not sure, sir. That I, because SharePoint, we were using for the files sharing, accessing the, with the different departments. But it like AngularJS and different software applications are there which can save data into a database. But about the SharePoint, I'm not sure. Web applications are there, many softwares which can save data into a database. Yes, after going to a new line, that will automatically save. Okay, then this is a simple query of getting a, like a based on the where conditions. Next we'll see, we have seen how to get the data using a select query, how to filter the data. Okay, I think we have listed out here some more options. We'll discuss about these commands. Yeah, here sheet versus table, we understood a sheet can be equivalent to a table. Okay, additional benefit is these table columns will be validated. They will be a specific data type that we define. We write a create statement for creating a table. Okay, a sheet means just we'll simply add a sheet. But in case of a table, we are going to define a table with a specific columns. Okay, we are going to define my table is going to have this many columns. That is the data type of each of the column. And so whenever we add data, it will be has to conform to that definition. That's the advantage of having a table over a normal sheet. Next, to read the data, just we say select a range of in a sheet or current region or selection, we'll use it. But here in the SQL, we use a select star from select statement to get the data. Similarly, we have seen we can use a where clause to filter the data. Next is we are going to sort data in an Excel sheet. Okay, clicking on a button, it is going to sort it. Same way in a SQL, we use the order by clause. After the where condition, we can use order by to order the data. Okay, supposing here, after doing this, now presently it is sorting by say some James name or letters, we'll remove this condition. All the customers in the Houston, I'm getting now. This I want to sort them by the say customer name. So I can use another condition order by. Order by. Give which by which column you want to sort them. You want to sort by customer name. So you can say C dot customer name. So this is going to display sorted by alphabetical order by sorted. This is by default, it is ascending order. If you want to sort by descending order, you can say DESC. So it will sort by descending order. So either way, this way we can sort the data by ascending or descending order. C is the alias name for the customers. Instead of again saying customers dot customer name, I have just used a temporary name, giving an alias name to the customer. That is an optional, that is only to improve the readability. If you don't want also, if it doesn't matter, as long as you are using one table. Okay, if you are using multiple tables, you need to have an alias, because you have to clearly say from which column is from which table. Okay, this is a right practice to have an alias name for each table. That will clearly tell us. Okay. Now we will do one thing. We will get data from two tables. Then we will more understand more importance of these alias names. Why we are using alias names? To understand clearly, we are going to use the multiple tables, get data from two tables. Okay. A semicolon is basically a end of the statement key. Okay. Now if I select this text, then if I don't give a semicolon also, it is going to run. But supposing I don't select here, if I click on a execute, now it is not going to decide which column, like how they are divided into multiple queries. Okay. That is why we use a semicolon, saying that this is the end of this one query, next this is another query, and this is the third query. Okay, semicolon is to identify that the query has ended. Now let me see how to write a query consisting of multiple tables. Okay, let us go to a new query window. Here, now we are having data in transactions as well as customers. Now I want to see that. Say one simple statement as how we have learned is select star from transactions. Okay, this is going to return all the columns from the transaction table. But I don't require all these things. What I want is the customer name, product name, sales quantity, sales amount, and quantity. Okay, so what I will do here is I will first add customer ID. Comma, product ID, because I don't have the names available in this table. I'm able to select only the customer ID, product ID, sales, comma, quantity, from transactions, okay? This we got it. But now it doesn't make the full meaning. We cannot do any reporting on this one. What I want to know the customer name. So for that, I need to get data from two tables. So here what I have to do is from transactions, comma, customers. So both the tables. So when you are using two tables, you should tell the system that the customer ID in the transaction table is same as the customer ID in the customer table. Okay. So before writing this customer ID, it was fine. But once I added customers table, now it is showing in red color. You can see it says ambiguous column name customer ID. Why it is giving error? Because this customer ID column is available in the transaction table as well as customers table. So when you simply say customer ID, it's not able to understand from which table you are asking to get the data. Okay. So that is the reason we have to qualify each column with a table name. Either you can write the complete table name. You can say transaction.customerID, transaction.productID, transaction.sales, transaction.quantity. Otherwise, we can just give a short name to this one. Temporarily, we are giving a short name saying I want to call transactions by the letter T. So that everywhere I can say T dot. Now you can see there is no red line. That means it is able to clearly understand the customer ID has to come from the T table. Okay. That is the purpose of adding aliases. Similarly, for every table, let us put the alias so that tomorrow when we add the product table also, you should not give error. Sales quantity also. Let us have the alias name for each column, so that it is very clear that all these four columns I am getting from the table called transactions. When there are two tables, now I need to decide what is the relationship between the two. I have to again mention it in the query. It's not going to go by the system relations, because system there could be multiple relations between multiple tables. So here I have to say what is the join condition, we call it. What is the relation, what is the condition we want to apply when getting the data. If I don't give any condition but run this one, okay, let us see what happens. Here presently I can see right side bottom 387 rows. That means in the transactions there are 387 rows presently available. When I add this customer table, I don't give any relationship, I don't say anything. Click on F5. So it's giving 150,156 rows. You can see so many rows have increased because this is called a Cartesian join. That means we have joined two tables. We have used two tables, but we did not give any join condition between the two tables. So what will happen is for each row in transactions, it is going to take every customer. It will assume as if every customer has executed all the transactions. Okay. That is why it is just multiplying number of rows in transactions into number of customers. That is the total number of rows we got it here. This is not a correct output. So we have to give a relationship between the two. Okay. For that, we can use, instead of just giving from, we can say left outer join. We have to give a join condition between the two. So here what we have to do is from transactions T, join customers. That means I want to join this transaction with the customers table. And while joining them, we have to give a condition on which column, what is the relation between two. On customers, again, we let us give alias name to this one. C on P dot customer ID is equal to C dot customer ID. So this is the join condition. While joining these two, I am saying transactions T join customer C on T dot customer ID is equal to C dot customer ID. That means we are saying whatever is the transaction ID in the transactions table, wherever there is a customer ID, you get the corresponding row from the customer table with the same ID and show his information. So what is the information we want? Now we can add those columns also here. Okay. Let me add here C dot customer C table. We have the different information. Supposing I want the customer name, comma T dot sales. Okay. Now I am able to get the data from both the tables, from the transaction table as well as the customer table. The like just like a VLOOKUP, we use the customer ID as a lookup value. Here I am giving a relationship between the two. Advantage with this one, unlike VLOOKUP is going to give only one row, but here this is going to give multiple rows. Okay. So we can use this relationship to get the customer names. We have done this transaction. So click on F5. So we are able to get the customer name, which is in a separate table, along with the sales done by him. So we are able to join two tables and get the information that is required to do any reporting, like customer wise sales or anything. We can do it now because customer name is coming from one table and the remaining information from another table. So this is what is called a join condition, wherein we are going to join. Okay. Similarly, we can even join multiple tables. Like supposing I want to get a data from product name also, I want to get it. So what we'll do here, customer ID, and again, we have to use the other condition also, join . So we are joining that product table also. And here I can show the after along with the customer name, I can also show product name. p dot product. So here we are able to get the customer name, product name, also quantities. So this is how we can use multiple tables, get data from multiple tables and show it in a single query. Okay. Like these different examples can be written wherein we get data from multiple tables and show them as a single output.
Hello.
Yeah.
If you have the same customer in three tables.
Same
customer.
Yeah.
Same data they have in three tables. So how can it identify that?
No, we are using customers as a master table wherein each customer there will be one row.
Okay.
The transaction table will have multiple rows for the same customer.
Okay.
So we are joining, so we are not going to add any rows. You can see the number of rows will not change.
Okay.
Alias name need not be the first letter always. Here we are using T for transactions, C for customers. This is not any fast and fast rule that it has to be only the first letter. I can give anything. I can say this as XYZ also. Okay, anything meaningful, understandable, we have to give. So first letter is same also, it does not matter. We can give a different alias name. Here only thing is, instead of repeating the complete word customers, we are using a short form of that one. That is the only thing. Okay.
How can we export into the Excel?
This. One easy way is just click on this button. Right click, say save results as, and say supposing on the desktop I have an SQL file here, I want to save it as say sales data. Okay, CSV means it can be opened in a notepad or in a Excel also. Okay, sales.csv save. I'll minimize this one. Here in the SQL query, sales data, this is the new one, click on this one. You have the data here available, same data is available. Okay, this is one way of doing it. Otherwise, if you know Excel VBA, from VBA, this SQL query, whatever we have written, this query can be used in a VBA. You can just create a connection to the server and execute this query and just import this into an Excel. So that can be automated. Instead of this, we are doing it manually by selecting and exporting. But if you want to automate it within a VBA, you can read that, this write this SQL query to read data from a server and update the Excel sheets. Or if you know Power Query, cannot be done, it can be done in Power Queries also. How to join primary query to three tables? You can write like this only, just using a join condition. Basically, primary queries will be there in the tables. A primary query means in the customer's primary query is customer ID. This customer ID will be usually joined to one table only. But if you want to join to multiple tables, it can be done. Using the same condition. This is here, we are simply saying join means we are assuming that there will be only rows that are matching in both transaction and customer table are returned. But there are further many types of joins, wherein sometimes you might have some customers who have not done any transactions in this period. Still, if you want to get those customer names also here, then we use outer joins. Okay, there are different types of joins available, wherein we can get data even without having the transactions. So is this query clear, or do anybody having doubts in this query? How to get data from three tables? So let us see, after this we will be seeing in a bigger database also some queries, but before that I want to just confirm that this is clear.
Yeah, can you please quickly repeat this query?
Yeah. Here what we are doing, first ideally we should execute it step by step so that we don't do any mistakes. Okay, so first what we have done is we have written a query on transaction table, because that is the base table for us. In the transactions, what happened? For that, we are picking up additional information from the master tables. Okay. So for getting the transaction from the transaction table, we use select. Okay, what is the data we want? It says supposing select only sales and quantity from this table. We can say select t dot sales, comma t dot quantity from transactions. We want to give it alias name t. Okay, so this is going to give only the sales and quantity for each row. It is not adding anything addition to that one. Okay. In this one, now I want to get the data from customer table. So I have to combine, join the customer table to transaction table. So here I will say from transaction T, join customers C. Okay. Giving some name, C or C, you can say C, UST, CUST, or any name you can give it. Okay, once this is joined, on what basis we want to join it? On e dot customer ID is equal to cust dot customer ID. That means we are saying these two are the common fields between the two. Here, basically, one of the tables should be having the primary key, customer ID. Then only we will be getting correct data. Supposing if customer ID is repeating in this customer table as well as the transaction table, then we'll be getting more records like we have seen earlier, Cartesian join. So here we know that customer ID is a common field and customer ID is unique in customers. So we are using this condition to get the data, all transactions from this one. So in addition to sales quantity and sales, I can get name from the cust table, cust dot.
Excuse me.
Yes, sir. Tell me.
You're adding two tables on the customer ID. If you want to add one more table, you can I write equal to one more table in join?
Again, you have to write join.
Again, I want to add only customer ID.
Yeah, still you have to say join.
Okay. Again I have to
join write. And give the table name and then the condition.
So join condition work only two tables.
Yes, two tables.
One time
you only. Join only two tables at a time.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
So here we can use any columns like customer name, comma, cust dot city or whatever we want from the second table. Okay, this is now we can join this one. Okay, we got the customer details. So now I want to get the product details also. Even if it's the same column or different column, we have to again write separately. Join. Products P on T dot product ID is equal to P dot. Sometimes you may have to join two columns. Okay. Single column may not be the sufficient to give a combination. Then we can also use two columns. Here we have to use the opening bracket. Say I can say T dot customer ID is equal to cust dot customer ID and T dot region is equal to cust dot region. Like supposing same person ID is there in multiple regions. Practically, when you are working, it is possible that there are multiple columns required to define a join condition. Yes, we are going to get records, same customer ID in customer table and also the transaction table. Cust table customer ID is not available, then we can use the outer joins, left outer join or right outer join is there, which is going to define, even if it is a null, it is going to display. Like say here, you want to get the customer names where there are no transactions also. Here we can say right join, right outer join. Customer on t dot customer ID is equal to right outer join means there are more customers than the transactions. That means there are some customers who have not done any transactions. Still those rows also you want to see. Okay. and here p dot product name. So this is how we can use the outer joins, where you want to get the data where even there is no some data available in some of the rows. That depends upon the data actually. In the data there is any row, then we'll be getting it here. Okay. Let us see, supposing another benefit of the SQL queries is, supposing I want to get the data, summarize the data. I don't want so many records. Directly I want to get the summarized data. Let me show that. I think that query is already there. I will just run that query. Group by. Okay. Here, what we are doing is, I'm getting so many red marks because I'm on sales data, but this query is related to AdventureWorks. So let me change this to here, AdventureWorks. Okay. Okay, sir, I'll see, show you this one also. Before that, let us see one very good example wherein I want to see the product name wise. This is at another live database, like it's a bigger database. The sales data, it was a very small data. Supposing I want to work on this database where there are many rows or there are multiple tables are available. Okay. In this, I want to get the total sales. Okay, let me define the requirement here. I want to get the sales amount, sales quantity. So get sales quantity by product. Okay. For the year 2013. So the data is there for multiple years, but I want to see only the 2013 data. And also, I don't require all the rows. I want to get only the total product and the quantity. Get product name and sales quantity, okay, for the year 2013, where quantity is greater than 500. I don't want small transactions. Only I want to identify products which were sold greater than 500 during 2013 and how much quantity has been sold. So this is the query for that one. First we are saying select the product name, and also the, instead of using quantity, I'm using sum of the quantity. Okay, I'll get the directly the total quantity. I don't require each row wise quantities. I'm directly getting the total of the quantity from this fact. Internal sales is the transaction table here, just like transaction in the previous database. Here internal sales, this shows the total sales, and this I am joining to the product table on a product key. I can apply a filter, like instead of direct column, I can use even functions here. Year, you can see in the comments, built-in function year, year of a date returns the integer, only year part it will return. So wherever I want to see only the rows of this 2013, and I want to get each product, I want to get only one row showing the total sales for that product in the year 2013. And also I want to see only those rows where the sale is at least 500. So any product is sold for less than 500, I don't want to see. I want to see only those products which were sold more than 500. So let's execute this one. So this shows the product wise totals. Okay. So this may require some of the formulas being written in our, so we have to, same thing, we want to do it in Excel. First, we want to create a pivot table having the sales by product. We have to apply a filter on year 2013. Again, some of the values we want to say that I want only if the total is 500, greater than 500. So I'm not sure if I can get this directly filtering on a summary function. Okay. These are all things we have to do step by step in a pivot table, but here in a single query, we are able to get all the data. getting a product name and the total sale quantity for the year 2013. That too, if the product quantity is greater than 500. Okay, this is how we can write SQL queries. Once we get this query directly into Excel, we can do analysis much easier instead of writing all the columns, because this will be the latest data available. Summary on this, we can do it. Okay. Here, if you want to have a clarity, I can show you this is the fact internal sales. Supposing I want to see the transactions in this one, can right click. Instead of writing SQL query, we can even use this option, select the table, right click, and say select top 1000 rows. Because if you don't give that condition, it may take a lot of time to get the rows. So here he's saying select top 1000 rows, showing all the columns. This is just like our transaction table, wherein total date wise total transactions are available. Okay, from this, instead of reading so many columns, we are able to get only the required columns in the output, that to total by product. Like this, you can get the total by month or any grouping you can do. This is called a group by function. This is similar to a pivot table. Instead of creating a pivot table, we can use a group by conditions, wherein we can group data based on any of the field and get the sales for each of the group. Okay, we can apply a where condition to filter the data, or even after the sum, on a summation also, we can use the conditions.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, tell me, sir.
How can we verify that the data is correct or not?
Yeah, you want to verify whether the data is correct or not. We can write the same query. Let us say, here let us add the p dot niche name is there. Let us put the p dot product ID also. Product key. Okay. So when you are using here a product key, it has to be added in the group by function also. Comma p dot product key. So we got the output here. Supposing in this 477 column, whether 48 is correct or not. Let us create a new query. So let us say select product. Excuse me. Okay, so we are seeing select star from the fact internal sales. Yeah. Okay, here I want to get the F dot product key and F dot say sales. The quantity, no order quantity. Okay, is it the same thing? Let us see. Yeah, order quantity. Where F dot product key is equal to, let us verify with one of the products, 477. Okay. We got this many rows, 42, 44 rows we got it. Okay, it is showing 40, 80. So let us do the sum of the quantity. Here again, of course, we have to apply a filter. and year of f dot order date. Is it order date? Yes. Is equal to 2013. Okay, here we want the total sales. So these are the different rows, 40, 80 rows we got it. Okay, you can see everywhere quantity is only one. So 40, 80 rows will give 40, 80 quantity. Here also we got 40, 80. So this is how we can say that the total is correct. Okay. Just give me a minute. Okay. Kindly give your phone number and mail ID in the chat window so that we can share you the contents for the course that we'll be conducting on SQL. Okay. For any correspondence also will be useful. So please share your mail ID and phone number in the chat window. Okay. That's a request that I got it from the admin team. So let's come back to this query. This is how we have seen how we can use a group by function and order by. This, I think we are running out of time. That's why I'm just showing the query. But these are the different queries that can be written in SQL by joining even more tables in the equi join, or there are some cases where we can use outer joins. Okay. By using outer joins, we can get the data where that data is also not available. Okay. I'll show that example. I think one of the person wanted to see how the data will come when even when there is no data. Okay, in this customers table, I think we have created one row where there is no transaction because it was a new row we have added. Okay, this customer will not have any data. Still, I want to get it in the report. So first thing we'll do, we'll write a new query. Select star from transactions T. This is on sales data. Okay. Here, let me get select T dot customer ID. Comma E dot say product ID from okay. I'll join customer table. This join customers C Let us put from in a new line, join C on C dot customer ID is equal to E dot customer ID.
Sir?
Yeah.
I have one doubt. In this scenario, we have not customer ID in T table.
Customer ID?
In T table, customer ID we have not, but yes. We need to fetch the data from C table and T table also.
Yes, yes. That's what I'm trying to do now.
Which query is the help to us?
Yeah, this is what we are writing. Now, yes. Where?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. Joining the two tables, say yeah. Where? C dot customer ID.
Yes.
Like, I will say Z percentage.
Okay.
Because Z is not there in the customers, I am not getting any data. But now I want to get it from the Z.
No, sir. What? In customer ID, primary key is not available in T column.
Yes, that's what. In the customer table, we have added one Z.
Okay, sir. Okay.
We have added one pair record ZZ12345. It was not there earlier. So yes, this customer has no transactions.
Okay, sir.
Still, we want to get that information.
For fetching purpose, we added that column, right?
Yes, that's all. Yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
And here we'll add C dot customer ID, comma C dot customer name. Okay,
sir.
Now initially we are not getting this data, but now I want to get it. Here instead of join, I have to say left outer join and execute now. Okay, so left means, okay, first table is transactions, so it has to be right outer join. Okay, left side table is transactions, in that there is no row, but in the right side table there is a transaction. So we are writing like this. Now execute. Now you get. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. Now. Yeah, now you see, I have added the two joins. Said right outer join. That means when the two tables are there, the right side table, there is a row, but there is no corresponding row in the left side. So that's why I'm able to get it. These two rows. Okay. There are no sales done by these people, but still there are rows in the customer master. So we are able to get it using this right outer join. Okay,
sir. Thank you.
And this is how we can write many queries. There are different options available. So I think just to understand this one, if you are interested in learning in detail, you can attend a full-time course at our place. There we will be providing. Because now I think in a single day, we can't tell everything. But this, I think it's a given a clear clarity that how we can use SQL and what is the benefit of using SQL for a data analyst, that I think we have discussed on that widely. When we join a course detail, so we'll be discussing in detail about each of these joins and how to get data from multiple tables using the same key. So other things we'll be discussing in detail. So let me know if you have any doubts in what we have discussed till now.
So here 2% in the sense like in 1,000 records, 2% or how it will be?
2%, two rows.
Okay.
Because I have used a like condition Z, we got only two. Supposing I remove this where condition,
got it.
Some more okay. May be there. since there are so many rows where it is a nulls, or the customers are there but there is no proper data from the other one.
Okay.
Right outer join means it is going to give where it is matching and not matching also. Okay.
Okay.
Right outer join means it will show all rows in the transaction left table and also those rows in the right table which are having
scenario C table, right?
Pardon?
In this scenario, left table is C table, right table is T table, right, sir?
No, left table is transaction table, right table is customer table. So we are getting all transactions with the corresponding names of the customers. But additionally, we are getting those customers where they have not done any transaction at all. Okay. Left outer join means it will add all rows from the left table and matching rows from the customer right table.
Okay. In the transaction is the right table, right outer table, sir?
Yeah. Right outer join means right side table. First left table is transactions and right is customers. That be clear. We have written first transaction and then customers. So transaction is the left table, customer is the right table. Right outer join means additional rows will come from the customer, though there are no corresponding rows in the transaction table.
Okay, sir. Okay.
So you can try it out with even a simple example, like having only 5-6 rows in each of the table, then it will be much clearer. Okay. Yes. Okay. Once we actually we are planning for a course, regular course, sometime in the next week or sometime. So if you're interested, you can contact us. And we are going to like write these queries, and I'm going to share these queries with you as a Word document for you to practice. We'll also see, I think today time was not there. Otherwise, we can see how to install a server, how to install these databases, import databases from a dump, from a backup file. And then we'll be able to, you can practice in your own system also. Okay. We can also see how this can be used in a tools like a Power BI tool. Okay. Yes, sir, tell me.
In the course, actually, what is the content you are going to teach? Like, see, I mean, when you told like filter equals to where, sort equals to order by, pivot table equals to group by, is it comes from the experience. I completely understand.
Yes.
The comparison, we cannot see in any website also, such a type of comparison.
Yes, correct. From
SQL to SQL.
Yes, yes.
Correct. So it comes from the experience. So when you are offering the course, will it cover like uploading the data into the SQL, then there is a reporting tool in the which is SQL related, SSIS, SSRS, like writing a stored procedures and getting out of from that and creating some reports kind of thing. Will it cover or what is the content, sir? Syllabus.
Content we'll be sharing with you, sir. Have you given your mail ID?
Yeah.
We'll be sharing you the contents. No, we are not working on SSRS and SSIS. We will not be discussing. Our main target is for those who are working on Excel reporting to get the data from reading the data from SQL server. With these only, we will be using more examples, how to apply multiple filters, how to query from multiple tables. And also we can discuss how to implement that in a stored procedure.
Okay.
Okay.
But SSIS, SSRS completely depending on the SQL, correct?
No, that is the separate tools within the SQL server. That is called Microsoft or some BI tools, we call them as business intelligence tools.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
But everything base is SQL.
Yeah, base is SQL. Writing SQL queries, that is the most important thing. In SQL case also, we write queries from one table and put it in another. It could be from even multiple databases.
Okay, sir.
This SQL will be useful, basically become a better analyst. Or if you want to learn Power BI or Tableau, they do not require a SQL, but if you know SQL, it will be very easier to work on them. So finally, those tools, they are going to get data from SQL server only. On an SQL data, we are not generally going to implement Power BI. Okay, it will be on a bigger databases. So it will be useful. When you learn SQL, it will be a very good path for the somebody who is onto already MIS analysis, data analysis. It is necessary, basic requirement is to learn the SQL. So we might discuss some basic examples, how to create table, how to add rows, but our main concentration is only reading the data.
Got it.
Yeah. If you know VBA, we can show an example how to use this query in a VBA to read the data and populate an Excel sheet. So click on a button on a VBA, that Excel sheet, we can just get the data from the server and show it on a sheet.
Sir, I have one question.
Yes, sir. Tell me.
How is it the real-time work of SQL? Only 2-3 lines are 30-40 lines are query lines in real-time?
Yes. Lines might have 30-40 lines also.
30-40 lines. In this scenario, we have to learn, sir, in our institute.
I'm not able to understand your question. Yes, can you unmute yourself and please enter? Okay. Hello? Yeah, please tell me, sir. Hello, can you repeat your question? I think some grinder sound was coming.
That person should unmute. I think he is not unmuting.
Yeah. So,
the person who was asking question, please unmute yourself and ask.
Now you are able to understand.
Yeah, tell me, sir. What's
In this real-time work, 30-40 queries in this office work. Hello.
Depends, sir. Depends upon the requirement.
Now, yes, sir. That's why I'm asking, sir. After complete this course. Are you giving to the projects of 30-40 lines or 50 lines queries are giving to that project?
We will write complex queries. Now, today, example, I have shown in a small database so that we can understand.
Yeah, that kind of projects?
Yeah, we have big databases. We'll be writing queries on that. So that
because we need experience of two years of experience, but they are asking it's a lot of queries are writing the queries in this.
Yeah. We'll practice it. And if you can write even online also, we can discuss while I'm explaining. You can try it out yourself and then
online also small projects are available, sir. Big projects are not there. That's why I'm asking.
So we are going to discuss the complex queries also.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. We are going to write complex queries consisting of many tables. Supposing if you are able to write it with 4 or 5 tables.
Okay.
We have got a concept called union all. Wherein you are going to combine the result of 2 queries into a single output. We'll be seeing those things also.
These fundamentals are not enough for experienced candidates, sir.
Yes.
They are asking a lot of big projects.
If I tell everything, it will be confusing and you may get frightened. So I have just taken a smaller database.
But okay, sir.
We'll be going in depth on these queries.
Yeah. Okay, sir. Advanced SQL.
Yeah, advanced SQL.
Sir, is there any website where we can see Excel to SQL conversion? Formulas.
Exact formula you want? Like most of the functions are same, like a sum, all those things are. But I don't have any ready list.
Sure. Okay.
But exporting from Excel to SQL is very simple. You can just import the data that I have shown you. Data you can easily import it. Each function equivalent, I don't know, but because both are Microsoft products, most of the names will be same.
Correct. Yeah.
Yes, sum or average, all those things will be exactly same only.
Sure, sir. Okay. Thank you.
Right. Thank you.
Sir, I have a question.
Yeah, tell me.
So, would you be including? How to improve your performance in downloading the data, all the stuff in your course?
Yeah, when you are able to write the SQL query.
Right.
Now, what I understand from many of my students is, they know how the process, everything is there. But even small change in the query, they are not able to do. Just add a 1 or 2 columns.
Okay.
For that immediately that they will be able to implement after this course.
Okay, but in case if I have to improve the performance of downloading the data from the data source, those kind of concepts would you be including in the course?
There is any specific instance I can explain. So,
suppose if I'm running a...
We need to create some indexes based upon the...
Right. Would you be including all those concepts in this?
Yeah, it's only concept will be given. Overall query tuning, it's a very wide subject. Because it will be case to case we have to identify. But I'll explain what is the index and how it will benefit in the performance. So we'll see how to get the... Supposing this query is there. Normally, we click on F5 to see the result. We click on F8.
Okay.
It will show the performance actually, how it is executing.
Okay.
Explain plan, it is called execution plan. That will go into show us actually how the query is going to be executed.
Okay.
It is saying that this is taking so much time, but we can verify how much time it is taking and how to improve it by changing the where clause. Now, here, for example, I have applied a customer filter on C.customerID. But sometimes we may have to apply it on the other table based on that. And what are the conditions we are using accordingly? We can tune the query. That also will be explained. Yes.
At a higher level or is it?
At a basic level. So tuning, it will be basic level only.
Okay.
Yes, sir. One more question.
Yes, sir.
Initially, you showed a flat file in the Excel where we have all the columns in one sheet.
Yes.
Then you showed me that you divided into multiple three sheets and you make sure like all the columns, what is there in first Excel, first sheet has a same kind of data. And if I combine together all the three sheets, that is called like data manipulation or data creating the databases and all.
Yes.
Those concepts also will be covered in our course. Like how can we do from big database to how can we divide the stock schemas? How can we do that schemas and all?
Actually that, this I have just shown it. Actually, this is a data generated based on these separate tables.
Correct. That is correct. That's what I mean. What is the primary key here? What is the link we can do? With the flat file of first sheet, you created a three sheets, four sheets.
Yeah.
So if you combine the four sheets, I'll get a first file. But from first file, you divided these four sheets. So what is the primary key? What is the secondary key? How you considered? So is there any example?
This process will not be done. Actually,
Or
any SQL server database already, we are not creating a new database. No? Database is already there. Somebody is using for the application.
If I understand correctly, maybe he's referring for normalization, I think.
Yeah. No, I am not, we are not going to be an application developers. Our target is to do the reporting. Okay. So my concentration will be on, already design is there. Database design is always like this with the multiple tables. Okay. We'll be seeing how to get this data into a single source in the optimized way.
Okay, got it. Okay.
The reverse thing will not be discussing because that is basically an application designing. Because as a report writer, we'll not be telling application people how to design the tables. That's my opinion is that it's already database is there. We'll be working towards getting optimum reports from that.
Sir, to export from Excel to this SQL, that is one thing. Will we be covering only export of file from Excel to SQL or from other database sources also?
Actually, it is a basic wizard, sir. It's nothing much to discuss. Here, when I want to import data from any tool, there are already options available for importing the data. So you select any database we have seen earlier, right click and say import data. It will be inbuilt utility only. There's nothing, we are not writing any code here.
Is it optional?
Okay.
Import data is there. So I'm going to show you how to install this database server and also this utility also, Management Studio also. I'm going to guide you how to install it in your local system. Once it is installed, we can use these utilities to export data from this to an Excel file or to any other database or import also. Both are already import available These are the features.
Yes, sir. Exactly. These type of questions are asking in interviews, sir.
Yeah, we'll see the examples how to do this one.
Okay, sir.
Okay, how to import data. Yes, and how to export.
How to connect to other application to SQL, SQL to other application. These type of questions are asking in interviews.
Yeah, other application means?
In VBA to, in means Outlook to, and MS Access to connect to SQL.
Yeah.
Yeah, these type of questions are asking. Sir.
Yeah, we can. Like, we'll be discussing anything that is related to the reporting.
Okay.
Regarding application development, we will not discuss. But what is useful reporting? Like, sometimes yes, we will have to export this to Excel. Okay. And from Excel to SQL, like that, we'll be discussing. These utilities, we'll see the examples. And also, we have an option called backup and restore. SQL Server, we can take a backup. Like, supposing we get a sample database as a backup from the online, that how to import it into our local system. And what is the database available in local system? We want to export it to some other system. Those things we'll see.
Okay, sir.
Okay, sir. Thanks, sir. Okay, nice session.
And we'll still, see, if you have any doubts in your working, you can contact our office for our guidance. Through WhatsApp, we'll be able to guide you. Even before course.
Thank you, sir.
Supposing you're already working, you are stuck with any query, you can surely contact us. We'll be helping.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. It was nice session. Thank you, sir. Yeah,
thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. It was a nice session.
Yeah, thank you. Welcome.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you so much for the session, sir.
Thank you. Welcome.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Thanks for the
session, sir. Thank you, madam. Aur shaam mein
tarah pe nahi. Sir, I have some final question.
Hello.
Hello, sir. I have one final question.
Yeah, tell me.
With this, we can write any SQL queries with the same language, right? Like Google SQL, MS SQL, and Oracle, etc.
Yeah, most of the basic queries can be written, but there will be some built-in functions that are different for each language. When you write when you want to write a complex function, there could be small changes, like converting a date to text. Such functions are different for each database.
So those. Okay. But the basic funda.
Yeah, basic query will be same. So those things you can easily get it in online also. What is the equivalent of two char in Oracle? Like that, if you ask also, you'll get the alternatives. But how to actually write a query, how to join tables, those things, it will be clear.
Okay, okay. And I mean, how much time will it take to write a big query? I mean, what is the experience we require for this?
Depends upon the complexity. You can't say like that.
Okay, okay, yeah.